years of a distance has made it a lot easier for us to just actually be who we are.
There's an audience out there that is really keen to have us back.
There is a celebration of life in everything we do.
A-ha was a band that came from a very unlikely set of circumstances, from a country who had no prior record of international success, and blew up in people's faces, including our own.
Keep your clever line. We, as in A-ha, has an album coming out again. First single is going to be Foot of the Mountain.
The song The Foot of the Mountain is actually two songs taken apart and then put together. And the lyrics are, half of them are written by me, half of them are written by Paul. And this, I think, is probably the first time that it's been so clear that the two parts are separate and then put together. I like to look at it as a kind of an urban clutter versus a big open landscape. And that's kind of what the video is going to be about as well.
When it comes to the title, I think that's a question for Paul to respond to, because he wrote the part that has Foot of the Mountain in it.
You know, I live in New York, and to kind of refrain from going crazy, since I'm from Norway, we started going out to Woodstock in the weekends. And there's an artist community there, like a guy who couldn't stand sort of modern life anymore. And he bought himself like hundreds of acres and created an artist community, because he felt modern life was too fast, you know. But this was in 1910. So you can imagine what he would feel like now. So that kind of inspired me to write something, you know, because I love living in New York, but I always wonder, you know, would I love even more living in an open, with the foot of the mountain.
It works for me on the level that the two very different perspectives in the song. One is a kind of an introvert, kind of claustrophobic setting of someone trying to, you know, kind of describing a setting that crowds his space. And then the other part is the yearning and the longing for the big open space. The verses are looking like this, and the chorus is closing your eyes and imagining something bigger. There's that romantic ideal of a solitary life, something without clutter, without all the kind of noise that we surround our lives with all the time. And it's symbolized by these amorphic bubbles that kind of lift up and hopefully takes you along with them.
Foot of the Mountain, here's A-ha!
Paul and my band was called, for a while it was called Bridges, and we played a concert with many other Norwegian bands, and Morten was in the audience and came backstage.
Was that my school? I think I was 19, something like that.
I can just remember 19, you had 20. A long ponytail and a golden tooth.
Long ponytail. Everywhere.
And he came backstage and said, you're the best band in Norway, but you need a vocalist.
I didn't say that.
That's the way I remember it.
Yeah, but that's what I knew. I didn't know that you needed a vocalist. You needed me. But I was too proud to say anything like that. I was not an easy guy to be with in a band because I had a much stronger drive, and a lot of guys wanted to play to have fun. That was not the point for me. I wanted something else. I wanted it to matter. I wanted the music to really get me, you know, where it could. And when I heard these guys play, it changed. I was really stunned because it was just so powerful. The music was really, really strong.
I didn't for once think that it would happen the way that it ended up happening by, you know, finding my mates in Norway. That was out of the question.
There were four guys on stage when I saw them, and then they played for another year or so, I think, and then the others didn't really want to go as far as Paul and Magnum wanted. So they were gonna go to England and make it as, you know, become superstars, and the others didn't want to go. And that's when I had a phone call from Mags. He called me. I was still living at my parents' house then. And he called me up and said,
you would
have
still lived there if it wasn't for me. I mean,
yes.